everybody. Welcome. I'm Patricia Duff, and I am thrilled to have you all here for Common Good. That is the place for politics and policy, and we've got a very important conversation with our fascinating guests, so let's get right to it. As our recent election demonstrated, our nation is sharply divided, even as America is at a critical point in its history. Wealth was once broadly shared across a strong middle and working class. Now, many wonder if their families will be better off than the generation that came before. The financial crisis hastened the flow of wealth to the top, and now the pandemic may exacerbate the trend even more. We're looking more like the Gilded Age of the 1890s than the prosperous post-World War II era. How did we get to this point? Who are the evil geniuses our guest says helped unmake America? To explain these dangerous trends, we have our special guest, Kurt Andersen. Kurt co-founded the satirical magazine Spy, which used to make the wealthy of New York shudder and shake. He also served as editor-in-chief of New York Magazine and as editor-at-large for Random House. He's an award-winning author and journalist. His books include Turn of the Century, which won the New York Times Notable Book of the Year Award, and Heyday, which won the Langham Prize for Best American Historical Fiction. I read his last book, Fantasyland, loved it. It was original and brilliant. His latest book, and here it is, Evil Geniuses, is a very ambitious history of our political economy for the last 40 years. It's been critically acclaimed and has become a New York Times bestseller, and Kurt has made the story of our political economy a very engaging and very lively read. So to help us navigate this topic, we are thrilled to have another brilliant writer, Joe Hagan. Joe is a special correspondent for Vanity Fair and has also written iconic pieces for New York, Rolling Stone, and the Wall Street Journal, where he has profiled and conducted investigative exposés of some of the most significant figures and subjects of our time, including Beto O'Rourke, Hillary Clinton, Karl Rove, the Bush family, and Henry Kissinger. He's also recently released his new book on Jan Wenner, the co-founder of Rolling Stone magazine, and hosts the podcast Inside the Hive. Joe wrote a brilliant piece and spoke with Kurt Andersen for Vanity Fair a few months ago, and we are thrilled to be able to continue that conversation here. Kurt, Joe, we are so honored to have you both with us. Let's get your point of view about our hyper-capitalist world and what needs to be done about it. Joe, I'm turning the mic over to you.
Thank you very much, Patricia. I appreciate you guys having me on to talk to Kurt. It's always a pleasure. I was thinking about a part of your title today, Kurt, The Unmaking of America, and it would be hard to argue in the year 2020 that it hasn't been unmade. And your book has been a primer for trying to understand how we got to where we got. So let me just ask you the most basic question. Tell us a little bit about you. You locate the source of a lot of our problems that we're seeing today and everything that's happened really over the many decades to these evil geniuses. And a lot of them, some of them you've heard of and others you haven't. Maybe you can tell us a little bit, take us into who some of these people are and what your thesis is about the genesis of some of our problems.
Yeah, thanks, Joe, and thank you, Patricia. We have two sets of problems. One set of problems I wrote about in the book that Patricia mentioned, my last book, Fantasyland, which is the degree to which Americans for a long time and becoming acute in the last few decades have developed a very iffy relationship to the empirical truth, to reality. And Fantasyland I finished before Donald Trump was even nominated. So there he came illustrating my thesis, my 500 year thesis. Evil geniuses, I started thinking as I was finished Fantasyland, trying to figure out, okay, Americans are not necessarily committed to facts anymore, and they are unlike Senator Daniel Moynihan said famously once, people are entitled to their own opinions but not their own facts. I thought, but yes, that's true, but that's not all that led us to the unmaking of America. And I realized that there were very different people, not irrational fantasists at all, but rational, highly rational people who around 1970, in the early 70s, feeling as though they were about to be washed away by the late 60s and and rising liberalism and rising anti-business feeling and all that was afoot around 1970, 71. And they decided they needed to make a stand, really. I mean, the charitable view of my evil geniuses is that they were trying to, they saw it as an existential battle in 1970, 71, 72. So they took their leader, their philosopher king, Milton Friedman, and operationalized his belief, which he had just loudly announced in 1970 in the New York Times Magazine, the Friedman Doctrine, which is to say, it really simplified libertarian economics and Milton Friedman economics by saying, all that matters, big business, business period, are your profits, not other, not social responsibility, not responsibility to the environment, to your employees, to your communities, to the country, just your profits, period. End of story. And that became a rallying cry around which rich billionaires, most notably and early, the libertarian Charles Koch and his brother David Koch, began building a sort of whole set of counter institutions and trying to change America's opinion. Along with this group of CEOs of the very largest corporations called the Business Roundtable, which was founded in 1972, 73, around the same time. And they began building, again, a decade before Ronald Reagan was elected president, as their first great success, this set of institutions to change, to shift the paradigm, really, to convince America or a majority of Americans that the New Deal was obsolete, dead and gone. We didn't need any more big social programs like Social Security or Medicare. Maybe we like those, but New Deal's done. It's all about the rugged individual, meaning rich people and big business, and they should get whatever they wanted, and taxes should not just be a little lower, and they'd been being lowered during the 60s. Actually, and then during the 70s, but much lower, radically lower, as low as they'd been since the New Deal. So in all kinds of ways, with think tanks and university professorships and gigantic increase in lobbying and all sorts of ways, they did what I came to understand in doing the research for this book was much more of a concerted, orchestrated effort, strategic confederacy. I won't go quite so far as the other C word, conspiracy, but to make happen what they happen and to go from what they believed to be saving themselves from the socialist tide in 1970, 71, to really changing altogether the way we thought about what was fair and how much security and equality economically Americans deserved. And to make us, in so doing, within a generation, very, very, very different than the rest of the rich world.
Right. And one of the things you point out in the book that I love is you sort of make a comparison between, anything goes, if it feels good, do it ethos of the counterculture, you know, flip that over and turn it into the greed version. And they'd end up having their own sort of organized, you know, Woodstock of filthy greed that will animate in the 80s. And one of the interesting shell games they play, though, and I want to talk to you about this, is when Reagan comes in, there are lots of little deregulatory, policies put into place and the lowering of the taxes, but also a kind of shell game around the working class. They make a concerted effort to destroy the unions, to kneecap the unions, while also coming up with something for the working class to make them feel like they're on the same side. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
And I want to say, as you know, a sub theme of this book is how the Democrats, why Democrats and liberals like me, mm-hmm. not that I had any power, but I was, I certainly was a centrist neoliberal Democrat who wasn't particularly in love with unions, even though I was a member of one, and who thought who were complicit really in this hijacking, and we, not me personally necessarily, but baby boomers in college who were protesters and so forth in the late 60s, and then went to college and got good jobs in the 70s and 80s as the blue collar working class was being outsourced, offshored, crushed, losing their jobs because of globalization and technological change and the crushing of unions with which liberals like me no longer were devoted as our predecessor liberals had been. So the ground was already softened for the decline and of the one way that employees in America, really most employees, have any say or power vis-a-vis employers, which is to say unions. Then as they're about to crush the unions, and indeed as Ronald Reagan in his first great act of as president was about to literally fire all the members of the Air Traffic Controllers Union, which had been one of two unions which 6 months earlier had endorsed him for president. But this cultural schism and fish that had been developing for a dozen years from the late 60s anti-war movement through 1980 certainly gave a message to much of the white working class, unionized and otherwise, that they're you're not on our side. And so we got to a point over time, but not much time, a couple of decades, where because Democrats stopped having a distinctly different economic vision of fairness and the rest from Republicans, they became only slightly different. There was lots of differences on other grounds about abortion and race and civil rights and the rest, but on the economics, Democrats and Republicans stopped disagreeing very much. So much of the working class, the white working class, looked at that and said, well, neither of you are on my side economically. You guys over here, you Republicans, you don't like the same people I don't like, so I'm with you. And that's, you know, that's where we are today with so many of that cohort supporting Republicans time after time after time and more excitedly than ever in these last two presidential elections. So that's what happened. But again, you talked about the unions, and I was among the many things of which I was superficially knowledgeable but basically ignorant was the crushing of the unions and how central to this project it was, and really crushing. I mean, it wasn't just unionization declined. Yes, it did. But in the 1980s, with the sort of after the Reagan administration fired every federal air traffic controller when they went on strike, that was the message that big companies needed and took to mean, oh, when somebody goes on strike, we can essentially fire them. We can't technically fire them, but we can replace them and then don't need to hire them back. And that was done. And that was the sort of, if not death knell, because of course there's still unions and certainly in public employees, there's lots of unions. But in terms of private sector employees, the 1980s was a crushing, and along with a million other things that were done, which is to say the end of fixed pensions for employees, which most employees had when I was young, the end of affordable health care, and all the rest, all of the insecurity that was suddenly part of our economic system. That, of course, had a collateral effect of making employees of all kinds a little more nervous about ever pushing for more money, pushing for more benefits and the rest. So that's how it worked, as well as 100 or 1,000 other ways many of which were invisible and stealthy and weren't even as spectacular as the union crushing part of the operation.
Right. And these things... these deregulatory, the lowering of the taxes, the crushing of the unions, had all been written into the design of what they wanted to do. And the evil geniuses, I'm thinking, you know, back during when they were doing white papers in the 70s and having think tanks, they're thinking, well, these things need to happen in order to get to where we want to go. And in their minds, you know, we talk about them being evil. In their minds, they must have thought this is all going somewhere in our version of utopia, an America that we want to be a certain way, and it didn't turn out that way, right? So And I'm thinking, I'd also want to mention, you know, the NAFTA and other things that continued to make the working class feel insecure as, you know, globalization took effect and you started to see the corporatization expand even more. And that made me think about Trump and thinking about where we arrived. How is he fit into this? How does he, is he symptomatic of, you know, where all of this led us over time? And I know I've skipped over some history there, but people know, right. You know.
I mean, he is more symptomatic of the first volume in my two-volume history of how we unmade and messed up America over the last 50 years, which is to say this fantasy land belief in preposterous conspiracy theories and facts or whatever I want them to be and all that. But he is symptomatic of the economic rights Faustian bargain politically, which is to say, yes, these Ayn Randians, including Ronald Reagan and Greenspan and Friedman and Paul Ryan, all of them, these earnest, serious economic rightists thought that as close to zero as you could make taxes, as little as government could be assigned to do, as little regulation as big business of any kind could possibly have, that was the road to utopia. Well, it turned out, and some of the purists of that faith may argue that, oh no, but we didn't do it right. Not unlike the way that certain kinds of socialists, communists have argued for a century now that, oh no, we didn't mean the Soviet Union kind of socialism, we meant the good kind. So no, it hasn't worked out well. And what has happened is, of course, I mean, in basic terms, is that it's not just that the very rich have gotten an outsized, a crazily outsized share of wealth and income over the last 40 years, much radically more than in any other rich, all the other rich, prosperous free market countries in the world. But that 80% of Americans have either had flatline wages or declining wages and wealth for those 40 years. So that is not, I think, at least in any of the grand, from Milton Friedman to Hayek to Reagan schemes that one read or were said, that wasn't the idea, but that is what has happened, because this promise, this trickle-down supply-side promise that if we just keep taxes super low on rich people and business, well, that'll create great jobs and everybody will do fine. Well, that didn't happen. So as I say in the book, I mean, we around 1980, people, Americans were sold, in my It's a Wonderful Life version of America, they were sold Bedford Falls as a future. We'll go back, it'll be nice, it'll be a small town, everybody will love each other and they'll know each other and it's great. Instead, you know, we ended up as Potterville. And here we are. And again, in the book, I talk a lot about how the kind of sort of efflorescence of nostalgia in the 1970s and 80s was used, not created by, but used by my evil geniuses, by my masterminds, to sell this bill of goods that no, we'll go back in time when government didn't do anything and everything was fine, everybody was nice to each other, and we lived in small towns and we didn't have these meddling bureaucrats and all the rest, which was, you know, not only a kind of selling, of overselling of a nostalgic fiction, but it was quite the opposite in the end.
I was thinking, it's interesting to me, I was trying to think about, like, what was the inflection point in the last 20 years when some of the scales began to fall from people's eyes about what the effects of all this were. And I always, in my own mind, I think of it as the 2008 economic collapse, when you really people were really, had their eyes opened to, you know, what the ramifications were. And it kind of split two different ways, right? You had the Tea Party and you had the Occupy Wall Street and different reactions to it. And I know that your own interest in understanding the economic roots of all this began quite a few years before all this. You'd been sort of collecting notes along the way. Yeah. And where do you sort of pinpoint where your own realization was that, oh, everything that I assumed was true, and you know, you a moment ago you were talking about, you know, the democratic liberal useful idiots, we'd all been sort of playing in the pig pen of capitalism ourselves. So when did it sort of shift for you, and where do you see?
Well, I was doing fine. My job wasn't uncreated. You know, automation didn't hurt my ability to earn a living and all the rest. Around in the 2000s, in particular, I mean, the first time I had taken a little bit of the red pill to see the reality was in 2006, when still, you know, there was no recession, there was no Wall Street meltdown, there was no mortgage bubble about to burst. But then I met some people and talked to some people who were doing really badly, and who had played out the American dream and been screwed, and that got me thinking that, well, yeah, this hasn't worked out well for not just those guys but for most Americans, and that's really where I began thinking that I hadn't paid enough attention to what was going on, and hadn't because I am by nature or by training or by something a kind of anti-conspiracy thinker, and that was a lot of what Fantasyland was about. That actually blinded me a little bit, or blunted my ability to see that there was an organized effort of an extraordinarily successful orchestrated kind by these economic right wingers. So I started collecting notes and thinking about it, and did other things and wrote novels and so on, and then wrote Fantasyland. But then I realized, wow, I've learned a little about this stuff, and now I need to really go in deep and learn about, you know, regulation and financialization and all this other stuff. And it really, you know, I won't say it radicalized me, but it might not be too strong of a word. I was just repeatedly dumbfounded by all of these things that were done in plain sight that I barely noticed or didn't notice. Like, for instance, just one of many, you know, this small rule change in 1982, Reagan administration, Securities and Exchange Commission, that suddenly allowed companies, public companies, to buy their own stock, to jack up and pump up the stock price. Well, that hadn't been allowed for the first, you know, for since the New Deal, since the 1930s, since the Great Depression, and now it was allowed, and now that's how companies spend most of their earnings. And again, that's just one of an array of ways in which the system was rigged. Again, a different kind of phrase that, because I try to be a subtle liberal, I rejected the, you know, rigged system, you know, you damn billionaires. Now I'm going to start talking like Bernie Sanders as I say these things. But I rejected that. And I was a little iffy, frankly, in terms of, you asked about my own journey. 2016, I wasn't entirely on board with Bernie Sanders. And that's a whole other conversation about the Bernie Sandersites versus the Elizabeth Warrenites. But it was a slow motion road to Damascus. It wasn't an all at one epiphany. It was a decade in the aughts and early teens.
Yeah, well, and by the time you get to 2016 and after, well, you know, the rest of the culture is catching up to this as well. I mean, people are there's a belief that we need, on the one hand, with some of the progressives, a whole new system. You know, tear it all up and start again. You know, when you think about the problems that you've seen and studied that were exposed by your investigations and by what we've seen, actually, I think that, you know, the Trump era has opened our eyes to every fault line in our culture and in our society. And did you begin to think about, I know that you were a supporter of Elizabeth Warren, if I'm correct.
Yeah.
I don't know
if she would have been the right candidate, but I was indeed.
Yeah. Well,
she's correct and brilliant. You know?
Well, the correct part. Let's focus. Yeah, yeah, you know, yeah. What? You know, there's a part of me that feels a little bit hopeless, like you can never put this back in the box, you know. But on the other hand, in the reality of, for instance, Joe Biden becoming president, but in the kind of like gridlocked, you know, government that we're looking at, but ideally, what are some of the prescriptions that you might have for what we could do to make this, you know, you want to keep capitalism on some level, but you want it to operate correctly for people.
As it does, operates so much better in so many countries. The Nordics, yeah. Obviously, Denmark, right. Sweden, Norway, but even Canada, Australia. I mean, it's done better with safety nets and more of the rest. I mean, one thing I didn't mention before, you asked about Trump. I mean, how Trump is symptomatic is he was just,
there aren't.
He was not a,
there
a
are none.
Believer in any of, okay. of the economic rights, you know, ideas. So he was brought, they made a, again, he was the
It's really a shame. I spent 30 minutes trying to get on this fucking thing.
With bigots and racists.
So what do I do with my cell phone? I have to leave it on, otherwise I lose the internet and there's nobody here to help me.
It's a little hard to talk over that. And so he is a symptom of the Faustian bargain that these rational economic right-wingers made over the years, and the greatest one, which is to say the worst one. But how can it be fixed? To me, it's much more fixable than the fantasy land problem. I believe whatever I want and it might be crazy and untrue. I think it's fixable because it was unfixed. It was messed up. It was hijacked in my lifetime, right? 40 or 50 years ago. So if you can take a decently fair economic system and make it unfair, through all these mechanisms and tweaks and
right.
large changes, you can do the opposite. So on a basic theoretical political basis, I'm hopeful on that ground. But also, as you say, I mean, after the 2008-2009 crash and recession, there was, you know, Tea Party before the Koch brothers sort of co-opted the little Tea Party outbreak. It was this sort of anti-government, anti-bank, anti-capitalist thing, instinct outburst, as well as Occupy Wall Street. And then, you know, you look at the last, I think we may have talked about this before, maybe not, the last ad that Donald Trump played when he was running for president in 2016, this 2-minute big ad, it was his final play to the audience. And it was this extraordinary anti-Wall Street, anti-big business, they've ruined the working class, they've pocketed the money, we're gonna, you know, stop that. As well as, of course, we're gonna have universal health care that's better than Medicare for all and all the rest. So there was Donald Trump telling, in my view, the biggest of his big lies, that he was an economic populist, not just a populist in the sense of being a bigot and you know, not being politically correct and all those other things that populism today means. He was ran as an economic populist. So it seems to me as though the pieces are out there and the appeal of like, yeah, this system is kind of, this is rigged and let's make it fairer and so on and so forth. And I, again, as you know, I explained that how surveys find that that's true in the book, especially when you take off Republican and Democratic from what the things you're asking about. So, you know, there is a big opportunity. I mean, the professional Republicans, the Republicans in the Senate and Congress will say it's all socialism. It's all socialism. It's all socialism. But my belief is that Democrats have to push forward on economics. All of the other issues are different issues, and to my mind, climate aside, which is so intertwined with economics, economics is the lodestar. It has to be how Democrats brand position themselves, seem to be it that this is what we care about. We care about working people and middle class people, and we're going to do everything we can to focus on you, not some like, oh yeah, we have to give giant tax breaks and to big business in order to maybe create jobs for you people someday somehow. No, it has to be this direct, that's what we are, as of course the Democratic Party was in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s when they did okay, and when the economy was doing great, gangbusters, better than it's done almost, you know, in a century. So that to me is, you know, you can't be scared off by these momentary, oh my God, they're calling us a socialist. You know, if the freest of the free market countries on earth, again, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Norway, they are free market countries, as even the right wing determiners of what is a free market say, are growing, are prosperous, and have these incredibly generous, lavish social safety nets, social welfare state that make, you know, free college, just sensible economic programs that make people much more secure and much more economically equal. You know, I just think we made a lot of mistakes. We, the Democratic Party, made a lot of mistakes over the last 40 years in compromising and moving to the center as the center just kept moving right. And as I yeah. say before, you know, just ceasing to have a distinct economic vision from that of Republicans.
Right. And that's the, you know, the promise of the AOCs of the world and the progressive side of the party is that they have ideas, right? That are distinct from the old Koch Democratic economic non-ideas that you know, basically Rockefeller Republicans, that concept became just adopted by Democrats as their right. thing too.
But well, as I realized, as I've been talking about this book, as Republicans stopped having Rockefeller Javits, as there stopped being liberal Republicans,
yeah,
the Democrats just filled in and on economics became the liberal Republicans.
Right.
You know, so, you know, I always rejected it. And when people said, oh, there's no difference between the parties, I would always say, what do you mean? Look at the Supreme Court, look at all these issues. And of course, on many non-economic issues, there was a difference, but not on economics.
Let me, in a little bit, we're going to go to some questions, but I want to point out something that happened just this week that was really interesting and kind of made me think of you, Kurt, is that David Koch, who, you know, of the Koch brothers, who's one of the, you know, founding evil geniuses, right? One of your evil geniuses. He was in an interview in the Journal this week and saying that all of the things that he had helped fund and promote all these years had led to disaster. He, you know, the quote was, boy, did we screw up. What a mess, which was, wow, late-breaking revelation. But, you know, one of the things he said that was quoted in there I thought was interesting. He said, we've come to expect too much from politics and too little of ourselves and one another. And I thought, wow, you're finally becoming a socialist. Great. Took you a long time and you had to destroy everything first. What was your reaction when you saw that?
My reaction was lol.
Yeah.
My reaction was also, Wall Street Journal interviewer, you don't follow that up. Like, yeah. Let's have some more discussion of what you did wrong in that respect,
yeah.
rather than the, well, golly, there's so much division. It didn't work out too well. Well, how? Because I don't think he merely, you know, I don't think he means it, frankly. But
right.
again, I wanted to follow up, and I'm now eager and have ordered his book because I want to see what the heck, because he was out promoting a book. That's why he gave that interview. What he means, because he has not, I don't believe, abandoned his extreme libertarian faith in how our economy should be run and the norms and all that. I don't think so. I'll be interested to see what he thinks he did wrong. I'm not as St. Peter at the gates, I am not buying his repentance until I see the full explanation of it.
Right. And just to add to that, you know, the business roundtable, who this group formed in the early 70s, has also in recent years said, oh, we need to shift some of our focus from just pure shareholder value to, hey, how about the actual, you know, human beings on the other end of all of this stuff? So we don't know if any of this is like, you know, pure of heart or just a bunch of lip service, right?
But no, and I'm guessing the latter, but the latter is not so bad to the degree it's an indicator of what the CEOs of the 200 biggest corporations feel obliged to say publicly.
Right? And I think that's right, yeah.
And a year ago they did this. It's not good necessarily in and of itself because it's not gonna change things by itself. But as an indicator, I'm good with it. I'm even good with Charles Koch, I guess. But again, all I know is that one astounding quote in the Wall Street Journal last week.
Yeah, it was astounded me too. So maybe it's we've been into the conversation 35 minutes here, and I think that I'm going to hand it over to Patricia to field some questions from our audience.
Thanks so much. That was a terrific conversation. And very provocative. I have to ask you myself, we're gonna go to a few questions. First, Chris Lowe, then Steve Leeds, then Bob, Hope Winthrop, and down the line here. But I wanted to ask myself, you know, politics is about what's possible. And you really haven't addressed how you move forward. How do you address the 70 million people who voted for Trump? How do you make them feel heard? How do you address the people who even split the ticket? They may have voted for Biden, but they didn't necessarily vote for a Democrat down the line. I'm not sure I'm getting how you fix that, if that's what you want to do.
Well, we did win the presidency, so that was the not sufficient step, but without it, in my view, we would have stepped into the abyss and been lost. So yes, 70 million plus people voted for Donald Trump. And then the question is, how many of the what are the reasons they voted for Donald Trump or not for a Democrat? And there's obviously within both parties, but especially within the Democratic Party, a debate about what that is. And I think what I said to Joe earlier about focus becoming the party for a better deal for the middle and working class is it. And the other issues that you may care about a lot, what are lumped into identity politics questions and cultural questions, most of which, many of which aren't really that addressable by the federal government, you make secondary to your pitch as a party. And certainly you let everybody who's running for the House of Representatives, for instance, be a Democrat that they need to be in their own districts, right? I'm not saying, and therefore go centrist everywhere, not at all. Focus on economics. I mean, James Carville said when he was running for when he was managing Bill Clinton's campaign in 1992, famously, it's the economy, stupid. He meant something much narrower, which is to say more jobs and less inflation and all that right now. I think it's the economy, stupid, in a much bigger way, which is to say, this is an unfair economy in so many ways. Democrats have not been making that case aggressively and well, except for the progressives, and that needs to be made. And you don't, it's not, again, it's a long game. And if nothing else, this history of the evil genius has taught me, it's a long game. You know, they didn't do it overnight. They did it pretty quickly in a decade or two, but it takes a while, and it takes keeping your eye on the prize and not like going all over the place and saying, we're also this. You know, it's tough, but I mean, what you have to do is to get more of the Trump voters. And by the way, Trump is gone. Now there may be a would-be Trump, it may be Trump Jr. who's the next nominee, who knows? But let's focus on the Republican Party and what they are selling, and how much of it is this false nostalgia about, oh, let's go back to a time when women didn't have much power and Black people didn't have as much power and this is a whiter country and all those toxic nostalgias, and how much of it is what I said before. I mean, the Democrats don't do very much for me economically, and so I'll vote for these guys who I don't like the libs. So, and these guys don't like the libs. So, I really think it hasn't been we've only had a faction, a growing faction of the Democratic Party that has been to my view, saying the things that need to be said, focusing on the things that need to be focused on, the economics, for the last decade, really. I mean, and but, you know, so it doesn't happen overnight, but I think that's what you do. I mean, yes, there are some irredeemable, you know, crazy people, bigots, whatever they are, who will never be gotten. But I don't think that the a party whose central fundamental, the powers that be in it, including Charles Koch, that their interest, the interests of the rich and big business, this tiny, at most, let's say 20% of Americans who are doing well, have convinced half or more of the 80% who aren't doing well to vote for them because those middle class and working class people want those rich people to get richer. So that's to me it. I mean, it's a long-term reframing, not just reframing, because that sounds like it's a marketing stunt, of focusing what the Democrats are selling on economics and not getting sidelined by all the other, as important as they are, issues that many parts of the Democratic coalition are most concerned about. And as I said at the beginning, along with climate, but economics, 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 it's the economy, stupid.
Well, that's a good point. Let's go to Chris Lowe, happens to be in the Democratic Party, and then Steve Leeds, who's got a question about a slightly different issue.
Hi, Kurt.
Hi.
Great to see you. And I've been a big fan of all your writing, not least of which because my wife, Bonnie Dack, used to write for you at Spy.
Wow, yes.
Many years ago.
Yeah.
And she's going to be sorry she missed this today. From what I've heard you say about evil geniuses, I think it's going to be a book I'm going to really enjoy. But one thing I've always wondered about this issue is how much a willful underfunding of education has contributed to where we are now, and how much part of the solution is a willful overfunding of education as part of a very long game. And in part, that should also help us address this issue, which I think speaks to the 70 million that Patricia mentioned, that we're living in a country where everyone has their own view of the truth.
Yes.
And some people don't have the ability to tell what's true and what's not anymore.
But yeah.
Well, the education and the underfunding is what interests me.
Yeah. Well, I wonder about that. I mean, I'm all for funding education more, especially higher education, which is where the woeful underfunding has happened in the last 40 years. It's a good question about whether, to what degree the belief in whatever I want to believe, vaccines cause autism, there's no such thing as global warming, or any other conspiracy theories or whatever, how much of that is a function of the lack of funding of public schools, and how much of it is other cultural things that well-funded public schools maybe wouldn't have stopped? You know, I don't know the answer to that. Now, what I do think is that cuts in funding of public universities, public higher education, mm-hmm. beginning in the 1980s, which made those tuitions for the great portal to upward mobility in America become more and more and more unaffordable for the people, the lower half mm-hmm. of the economic pie. That has certainly had the effect making people resentful, unhappy, and not blaming the correct people for their problems, you know, which is to say, Republican state legislatures who have just resolutely cut funding for public universities around the country. But it's an interesting question, and I don't know, you know, yeah, you would think that if critical thinking and empirical reality and science and all the rest were taught well in our public schools, that some number of those 70 million would be sort of educated out of whatever their misguidednesses are. I don't know the answer to that, but I'm, you know, no harm in making a long-term project to fund education.
I would only say if I were one of the evil geniuses and I had the plan, which you outline, you know, part of succeeding that plan would be make sure I had a pretty ill-educated mass populace.
I guess. Makes it much easier. But you know, wouldn't you also think that they could come, eventually they'll turn and decide to take their pitchforks and torches and come at me? You know, I don't know, maybe.
Depends how underfunded it is. Anyway, I mean, it's a theory, but yeah.
Interesting theory and interesting answer. We may have time for one more. Let's see, we've got Steve Leeds. Sorry, Hope. I think we just barely have time to get, if it's a quick question.
Yeah, I'll make this quick. Kurt, I look forward to reading the book. What importance do you place, if any, on the role of the courts in finding that corporations have all or almost all of the rights of individuals?
I put a big, long chapter of Evil Geniuses is about the rewriting of the law, of encoding all of the pro-corporate, pro-oligarchic, pro-economic efficiency at all costs into our law through the Federalist Society and other means. So it's huge. It's a huge part of it. And Joe referenced the white papers and memos at the beginning in 1971 and so forth. That was part of the plan, you know, it doing exactly that. I mean, again, like so many of their parts of this project, it succeeded beyond their wildest dreams and hopes, but absolutely. And that's, again, just a piece of it. It's not just the corporations are people too, and thereby in Citizens United making effective campaign finance regulation unconstitutional, but it's many, many, many other ways in which this shift is not just a shift in thinking. It's not just a paradigm shift. It's not just a shift in a law or a tax rate that can be changed. It's this deeper re-encoding of jurisprudence that is at least a generational project to fix.
You know, his book actually gives an amazing chapter just on rule of law and what's happened with justice in America. So it's the book is fantastic. It's so readable. I don't agree with everything, but I think it's a really important conversation to have, as is this one today. So thank you, Joe. Thank you, Kurt, so much for sharing this time with us. And everybody, let's just hope that we can chart a path back to a better, fairer America. If you haven't bought Kurt's book yet, please do so on our event site, and we can get book plates signed by Kurt that you can put in the book. But thank you so much, Kurt and Joe. Thank you for this provocative conversation. We've got some terrific events coming up. Well, one with Chris Whipple on the CIA and their role in the last decades, French ambassador to the US, Philippe Etienne, and many more. It's gonna be Thanksgiving next week. So we're going to take a pause in our chats next week, but on behalf of the common good, I wanna wish you all a safe and happy Turkey Day. And thank you so much for signing in. We had so many terrific people here. I'm sorry we didn't get a chance to hear from all of them. Thank you.
Thanks.